George Kokola and Virginia Dooley.
Hi, Dina. Welcome.
Hello, George. Hello, and hello, Michael.
Hello, Dina and George.
And hi, everyone that's joining us today on episode...
Eight. It's episode eight. We have reached episode eight, of Teacher's Coffee Podcast. Thank you, Michael, for being here with us today. Well, maybe I need to set up a little bit the context. I had the privilege to meet Michael in a conference in Crete last summer. And back then, you know, I didn't know anything about him. I didn't know anything about English language teachers in Israel. But apart from his wonderful presentation, what really attracted my attention was that Michael is not simply a teacher of English. He's also a poet.
Ooh. That will be interesting.
So
we haven't had a poet up here before.
Exactly.
Oh, great. I'm glad to be the first. May I not be the last?
Wonderful.
In favor of all poets.
Exactly. So we thought maybe, that you would be a great contribution to this podcast and actually give us the opportunity to talk about something different compared to what we usually talk about in this particular show. So I would start with the basics, Michael, because, yes, of course, when we introduced to each other, you told me that you are a poet. But then when I started reading your previous interviews or more things about you, I also read that you are a poet, a writer, a songwriter, a photographer, an artist. Also, in brackets, husband, dad, and teacher, which makes absolute sense to me, absolute sense. But I would like to hear from you, how would you introduce yourself today to our listeners? I mean, all these different, let's say, parts or aspects of your professional creative life, do they overlap with each other? Which one do you think actually characterizes you?
I would say writer and poet is the most focused part of my life, including my reading and writing and some of my teaching. Of course, family is always big, so I'm sort of, I guess I'm speaking my professional life. Family is very important to me. So maybe I would start with writer and poet, dad, granddad, and husband. And I would go on to say all of it interacts.
Mm-hmm.
I always like to point to Blake, not that I'm anything like him in either art or words in terms of talent, but, you know, William Blake, the English poet and woodcutter, painter, who made amazing artwork combining his visual arts and his words. I do that sometimes with digital art. So I think all of it combines. I'm a guitar player. I do a lot of guitar playing, but it's been a long time. I used to do some on stage, not usually for money, but I did have a steady gig for a while where once a week I played at a vegetarian restaurant and got dinner. Tips off the table. Paid for guitar strings, you know, and paid for my gas there and back, and I got a free dinner. So yeah, I was young then. That was a big bonus. But I do play guitar. I mentioned that because I've taken it into my teaching. I have used my guitar and some simple English songs sometimes at the beginning of classes to get things warmed up. Even when I'm teaching college students at CAP, it's kind of nice to have something fun and relaxed to do at the beginning to reduce the anxiety, practice some English.
Of course.
Warm.
Yeah.
But I also taught I taught an education course at a college in northern Israel here that was using songs and music and games. So I brought the guitar every week to that class. So I do, everything overlaps for me. I read this term. I don't know how many people know it, but when you talk about poetry and literature, there's something called an incorporist. Someone who incorporates everything.
Absolutely.
I was reading about Robert Bly, who I knew personally and also admire his work and have learned from a little bit. And there's someone who called him an incorporist. Incorporatist, but I incorporate everything. I bring it all together. It's a holistic approach to life and to work, and to particularly my art and writing, but also my teaching. Yeah, sorry.
No worries. It's very interesting what you're saying. You know, you do all these activities, and you know, apart from music or guitar playing that you mentioned earlier. Being an incorporist, how do you incorporate all of these activities that you engage with within the language process, language teaching process?
One is talking about all of it, but also bringing in, I mean, I've taken into my classes visual art for students to write in response to and talk about in their English, to practice their English. I always play with language, and I encourage my students, especially my writing students, to play with language, to loosen up. I know, especially when we're teaching people who are not native speakers, we have to focus on teaching them some of the technicalities and the rules, but I want them to loosen up in their writing and forget that a bit as they write a draft, for instance. And so I encourage play. I encourage drawing sometimes to help them focus ideas. I bring music into the classroom, not only me playing, but sometimes we have music in the background. We use music to relax students, but also to connect. You know, it's a way of doing things. I also teach, besides teaching language per se, I've taught to non-native speakers here at Bar Ilan University. I was teaching literature. And so when I would teach a poetry course or poetry lesson, I started out actually with songs that have been made from poems. There's an Israeli musician who uses One Art by Elizabeth Bishop and has turned that into a beautiful song. And I brought that in because he's Israeli, but it's an English song. And it's a poem from Elizabeth Bishop that I wanted to study. And, you know, but there's other. Leonard Cohen's done a couple of songs that he sings aren't his words. They're poems of others, just two examples. So I bring these in to get students warmed up into the classroom. But I also have done it with language classes, bring in songs. At Hebrew University, I would bring in, I have a song book that I picked up before I was an English teacher, but I was working in a hospital as it happened, but a woman who we worked together on a psych unit, I would sometimes go down with her doing music, and she taught English as a second language, and she had put together a booklet of songs where she corrected some American folk songs incorrect grammar, but she did it to apply to certain lessons of verb conjugation or categories of words. She had different songs to do it, and I brought those songs into classes, and we just sang that song a little bit at the beginning, again, like I mentioned, for warm-up or something. Look at the words, see how they're put together. I think rhymes help with vocabulary buildings. I write some rhymed poetry, but it's not central to my poetry. I don't always write rhymed poetry, but in terms of reading poetry and bringing it to the students, I often use the rhymed poetry because it helps both remembering it, but to recognize pronunciation, because you know that this word's going to, once you find the pattern, you expect it to sound like that other word, and to help them to learn words. You know.
Yeah, makes sense.
That's wonderful, Michael. And actually, I was thinking that the way you describe now things to us, you seem to be the perfect embodiment of creativity And I mean that. I mean that. No, I mean this
is important. I don't know about perfect. How about an imperfect body?
Well, even imperfect, you still, you know, like a modern, let's say, because from what you were describing before, Leonardo da Vinci is my absolute model of exactly this embodiment of having all these different abilities or dexterities or skills, or because he was also
Da Vinci,
so many.
Michelangelo, the so-called Renaissance person. I'm going to say person. They usually say man, but I ought to know a woman or two from that period, but I don't to apply to this. But I'm sure there were. I know
of
that there were women scholars in the Renaissance that who have been erased. I just haven't picked
absolutely.
Them up yet.
Absolutely, but I think it's great that you're bringing this very same spirit of blending the arts together and eventually helping the students, maybe inspiring them also to find their own path, because that's exactly what is happening, I think.
I really do want students to find their own path and their own interaction. I think that's very important to me. I'm glad that you said that, because I'm glad that comes across. I'm not sure if it was or not. But and I do. I mean, it's I had a well-rounded anyone in the old days would call a liberal arts education. Although at least in the U.S. and I think somewhat around the world, that idea of liberal arts education has come under fire because it doesn't produce high-paying jobs or something. But I wasn't thinking of that in terms of high-paying jobs. But I mean, in high school, I was an editor of the literary magazine. And I also went to the science fair and did well in the science fair. I was involved in science. I was involved in math. I was involved in literature. And even today, I mean, I can do computer stuff. I like to read about science. I'm not doing any I don't like to do empirical research anymore, but I have done it.
Wonderful.
And I do like to the students to find voice. As you know, most of my professional career – maybe you don't know, but you may have read it in the interviews, has been teaching writing. In the U.S., I taught writing. It was academic writing, but I also taught to ESL students. So it was also language teaching writing. And in writing, I always wanted students to find their voice, but also wanted them to find something they cared enough to write about that they would want to get it really right, and they would take the time to draft. And as you probably know, I'm sure both of you have written professionally, if not creatively, the writing is rewriting and rewriting.
Of course.
Actually, just before I signed on, I'm involved in a project that we've been rewriting literally for a couple of years now. We had a big pause, but I'm rewriting something that with a co-writer, we go back and forth, and we've been really rewriting it the past couple of weeks in a whole new way, even though we had a way that we were satisfied with a year ago.
Maybe what you have just said in a way connects with my next question, which has to do a little bit with the process. So when we come down to the process of poetry, would you say that is it all about, at the end of the day, inspiration? I mean, finding something to write about, or the final product? And what comes in between these two starting and finishing points?
I would say that all writing involves inspiration at some level. We sort of romanticize poetic inspiration. But the Greeks talked about rhetoric generation. Your ancestors talked about inventing or generating ideas to make an argument. But this is inspiration. It's how you work at inspiration,
mm-hmm,
in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And as a poet, sometimes you have to work at it. It's not like you wait for an arrow from the mythical muse to hit you. Sometimes that happens. Sometimes I wake up and I have a poem in my head that I think I dreamt of, or the dream spirits brought to me. I don't know where it came from. And it's a starting point anyway. But oftentimes inspiration is work. You know, you have to look for ideas. Reading, this is how we teach academic writing or rhetorical writing also, that read, you have to do, maybe it's research reading, maybe it's reading just to get inspired, reading other people's arguments and saying, well, wait a minute.
Of course, of course.
And similarly, I read poetry And a friend of mine, I have to credit Gary Lundy, another poet and a friend of mine, but a good friend of mine. It's his idea, but I've borrowed and stolen it. But the poetry I like is poetry that generates for me more poetry. That inspires me. It's inspiration. It's like someone asked me what's good poetry, and you know, there's a lot of people they'll answer, well, imagery, or well, a good narrative is a good poem. Other than images don't like narratives, so I tried to pick something that's the opposite. For me, any type of poetry, in terms of if you're talking form, genre, poetics, can be good if it's something that when I read it, it's like it's moved me into that space, that poetic space. So what's that poetic space for me? That poetic space that I want to move into with inspiration in the process is someplace between what I can comfortably and easily express and something that I feel that I know. It's called sometimes, again, in the rhetoric literature, in the writing teaching literature, felt sense. I have a sense that there's something that I understand, but I'm not sure that it's already in language for me. It's not received language. It's not received knowledge. I get into that space somehow, then I feel like I'm in the poetry space. And then I write, can I say a swear word? I write like, I'll say play. I write like Hades. I write like hell. I mean, I really write and write, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, and sometimes I'm, it's like word salad. It just comes out on, spills on the page a lot of different, like a toss, American toss salad, you know, it looks like it's a lot of different ingredients. Greek salads are kind of that way too. A lot of different ingredients tossed together. So this is, and then something emerges. Sometimes it emerges as I'm writing. Sometimes it emerges later. Well, my mentor of mine said it takes a year for a poem to be born. Has a long gestation period. So it's a process. I come back to it. I look at it while I'm writing. I do a lot of revising. I'm very different than a lot of poets. A lot of poets claim that, you know, they love their pens. A lot of writers, Neil Gaiman, do you know Neil Gaiman is? He's an American writer, he wrote The Sandman, which was recently made into a Netflix TV series. Books.
Yeah.
And he's an avid fountain pen collector, from what I understand from following him on Facebook, and he's got to have the right pen and the right paper to write. I like computers because I can just copy paste, move things around.
Mm-hmm.
I can play games with it, you know, in revising. So what do I do with my students to get them to play when in the revision stage? First of all, the generation stage, I do free writing, and I don't know if that's a term. I imagine most of teachers will know it who've taught writing anyway. We just have them write and write and write whatever comes to their mind, and you keep. Sometimes I throw questions out at them to keep them sparked, particularly with less experienced students. Maybe throw a few questions to keep them going. Some of them say, no, you're bothering me. I say, ignore it, just write what you're writing. And sometimes I don't. And I like them to write a long time. And then I have them go and say, go circle words that look interesting to you or catch your attention or phrases and stuff. And then I sometimes have them write those down in a list and cut up the list and shuffle it around and start pulling them up at random and trying to see which ones excite them. But I also have done a cut-up exercise with drafts. I have had them bring in typed drafts, double space, and have them cut out phrases and circle, or just I want them to cut them out. Cut out phrases and words, shuffle them around, and try to rearrange them. I've had them build sculptures. I said, cut them out and make a sculpture out of your, you know, a paper sculpture somehow out of the pieces that you make, something three-dimensional. I had a couple of students turn three-dimensional projects into me. This was in the U.S. with native speakers, I have to admit. That might be a little harder with non-native speakers. But I think mixing up the words, trying to rearrange them, see how they fit together, those are games in which they also can be practicing sentence structure, looking at how paragraphs work. Mm-hmm. I use the computer for this. This is what made me think. I have students take a draft. You can select all, and you can sort it.
Mm-hmm. Good.
So I have them actually take all of the paragraphs and at the end of every sentence make it a paragraph return, right? So each sentence is in a row, sort them alphabetically and say rearrange it. Sometimes I'll have them do that with the paragraph, rearrange the paragraph. Can you put them back in the order? Does it make sense? But mm-hmm. I also ask them to look when they do it either with paragraphs or sentences to see how many, then the ones that begin the same are in a row.
Mm-hmm.
How many times are they using the same things to begin? Do you want to change that? Does it work? Can you rearrange this? Wait, the sentence, you can't find a place for it. Maybe it doesn't belong in your draft. You know,
yeah.
But I try to do it playfully and make it games. I always have to say save, make this a save as copy. I should make that clear. If anyone is going to do this, don't have the students do it with their only copy. Have them save the draft as a new copy and play with it and do these games. But these are, I mean, this is some of the process of writing. And sometimes I play with my own things. I have rearranged things into alphabetical order. I make up forms for myself. And I've made up a very strange form that I call a cubist form of poetry. I write an initial poem, regular stanzas, and then I take the first line of each stanza and put it as a new stanza, and the second line and put it as a new stanza, and the third and put it as a new stanza, and the fourth. And put it's at however many lines a stanza has. And I make groups of those lines, and then I go back and forth until I kind of get those so that both of them make sense, so it takes some playing with the words, and then I take the first word, or maybe occasionally two words, like if there's an article, the first two words or a small phrase, going down the second word all the way down and make a third group of these, and I play with everything now to make all three of those match. It's a very complicated, abstract, that's why I call it cubism.
Mm-hmm.
Because cubists try to represent three dimensions at once on a flat plane. And I'm trying to get at three syntaxes, three semantics, I don't know what, three different dimensions of the language on the page at the same time and see how they both echo each other and totally change the meaning. And again, it gets at that, it's in between things.
It sounds very experimental.
Yeah.
A lot of freedom, a lot of playing around with the structures. But if we could go back to the poetic space for a minute, because you know I found that very interesting. Makes me wonder, like, what's your opinion? Could any teacher or student become a poet, or do you think it's a matter of it being a talent or a skill that could be learned and perfected with more practice? What's your opinion on that?
I think it can be learned and perfected with work and practice, but this is where I think inspiration comes in a different way. I think the mentor teacher has to inspire. I heard that Alex Pate, come from Minnesota, he's a Minnesota poet and author, talk at a writing center conference. I helped organize it. I brought him in as the keynote speaker because I thought he had interesting ideas about helping the students love what they have to say. He wasn't just talking about poetry. But mm-hmm. in poetry, in all writing you teach, we have to inspire them to write about things they love in the sense of like all love, there's give and take, there's hate and love. Can be combined anger and love, but it's that kind of relationship where you care deeply, but you really do want to love what you have to say about what you're writing. You may write about some things that are difficult, but what you're saying may be healing from the difficulty, overcoming it, whatever. So you, as mentors, we have to somehow inspire our students to love their own voice, to love their own words, and to free themselves of what they think. Okay, I am experimental, but to free themselves of what they think they should be doing and to do what they want to do and to work hard at it until it satisfies them and they think it's good enough to share with others and then find the others who get it. And sometimes you have to, I will talk about audience with students, but I often talk about it well into the drafting and revising process. I think it's something you revise for. First, you draft what you need to say and want to say so you understand it yourself. Writing to learn, we call this. You understand it yourself. And then, and this is how it goes with poetry. I work until I have an, suddenly the poem tells me what it's about, or I can see it congealing into something. I can see the form in it. Now, I don't remember, was it Michelangelo or Da Vinci who said the carving a horse is easy? You just had to look at the marble and see the horse and chip out everything that wasn't the horse. So in the poems, you have to learn how to do that and how to see it. But when you see that, then you work towards how do I communicate what I'm saying? How do I show the horse after I've seen the horse in the marble?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And after I start to do it, how do I show it to others? And maybe they won't see a horse. Everyone who looks at Picasso's famous sculpture in downtown Chicago outside the Civic Center doesn't see the poodle and doesn't see his mistress, his girlfriend. They're both in it. You have to walk around the sculpture. You have to look at it. You have to look at it seeing negative and positive spaces. And everyone doesn't see both of those images. And whatever else might be in that sculpture. Some people will see the poodle, some will see the girlfriend, some will see just a bunch of brown metal. What the heck?
Absolutely, Michael. And I think you answered my next question that has to do with the main topics. I think you hit the nail on the head by saying that practically what you do is trying to have the students focusing on their own and find their own topics that really can actually generate these feelings and consequently maybe this form of art. And I guess, you know, these topics can be, as you said before, anything. On another note, however, this brings me back something that was mentioned by Malcolm Gladwell in one of his podcasts. He said that, you know, specifically he was dealing with songs, and he was saying that the most emotional songs are the ones that become really, really specific. And the ones that really delve into sometimes human pain, or they talk about particularities or love or other feelings. And I can see, you know, something really parallel here with what you do. I think you are drawing your students into this specificity mode of being more observant, being more particular regarding creativity. And as we said before, find their own path. And from all this mixture and blending, something always good and creative comes out.
My feedback is almost always towards, this word is very broad. Can you make something more specific? What
there
is
you
it
go.
You really want to say here? Because this could be anything. What I have an exercise for. It's a writing exercise for the importance of these details. As I say, walked into the house and smelled like grandma's house. I said, okay, you think you've said something.
Mm-hmm.
What have I said? Say, write down what you smell. Write down exactly what you're smelling.
There you go.
It is all over the place. Of course, because every grandmother's every grandmother's house is different. And if we say I smelled grandmother's house, surely we're giving an image that the writer, that the reader will have and bring to it. But if you say, I smell apples and cinnamon, like my grandmother's house when she was making applesauce from her trees. Now you're smelling what I'm smelling.
Now I got hungry.
Oh, yeah. Me too.
Okay. Gina has prepared a really nice a roast question for you.
A strong roast. I really like strong roast.
Okay, but before that, I would like to ask you, what are your creative plans for the future? Do they have to do with poetry, more writing, maybe publishing a book or?
I told you I'm working on a project right now, actually. A year ago, we submitted it for funding. It's a grant for writing, but what we're working on is a documentary film. So right now, one of my main focuses is this documentary film. We're writing about we're writing about a famous writer is well known. What can I say? I'm a little concerned because we actually know there's someone else out there working on a film, but I guess we can say it. Because we made an application to a public organization so that someone can find it online somewhere. We're working on a film about Elie Wiesel, the famous Holocaust survivor. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you know his book Night is particularly well known about his experience at Auschwitz and Birkenau afterwards. We're writing it from a particularly specific point of view and perspective. My co-writer's father was born and raised as a crow flies 30 miles in Romania from where from Siget, where Wiesel was, and was sent to Auschwitz on the same train, the same tracks, the same day as Wiesel. And so my co-writer is sort of applying this lens to our looking at Wiesel. So it's a very interesting project. It's a creative project of a sort. It's a different kind of creative project because it's not entirely mine. It's a collaborative work. And the main perspective is he's a filmmaker. I've worked with him before because I've writing scripts and writing, doing research and writing for him. So that's the thing that's filling my time right now, because we have a January deadline for another grant we're applying for to produce the film now. We had some money, some success getting money to, it's called developing it, and now we're putting it out there to try to get money to make it. For my poetry, I don't know in 2019, I was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, a highly treatable form of cancer, thank God. And I'm in remission. I had my chemotherapy and stuff. I did, of course, write some poetry during that time and since that time about that. I think I have more to write about that experience, about surviving, and about, you know, even now with that little bit of a shadow, I have two more years, I think, now. And if I'm 2 more years without and in remission, then they'll say I'm cured. It doesn't often, this particular form doesn't recur very often, so everything is good that way. But there's something that overlaps that then is I got out of chemotherapy. I was in sort of an ongoing once a month treatment to make my bones stronger, and that got cut the last 2 months because of this thing called COVID. I mean, my oncologist called me and said, before the lockdown, just maybe only a week or two before the lockdown, he said, it's not worth the risk to your health for you to come in. It's not worth the risk to people getting chemo in case you're bringing it in. It's just not worth the health risk. These bone strengthening things aren't required. They're a nice thing, basically. So it wasn't worth my health risk. It wasn't worth health risk to other patients. And he was right. At that point, it was new. We understood that it was an epidemic, but it hadn't been quite declared a pandemic, and we hadn't gone into lockdown.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So there's a lot to write out of that I think I have during the process, but I think I need to sort of gather that. A lot of times what I do is go back. I write a lot, publish a lot, and then publish some. And I go back and go through what I've written, what I've published as individual pieces, and pull out related pieces to make a collection.
Great.
Great,
right,
yeah.
Dina.
Very interesting. Well, to lighten up the mood a little bit, to end on a high note, let's say.
I like that idea.
Okay, so the roast question is, was there a time that you found poetry, specifically poetry, uninspiring or even boring? And how did you fight that process?
In general, uninspiring or boring?
I mean,
specifically,
at the time of your...
Time of my life.
Life, yeah.
I honestly have to go back quite a ways. I'm going to be honest here. I wrote some poems in grade school and was excited about stuff about poetry in junior high school and high school. But also in high school... I'm trying to think if there's a college class. Now, in high school, there was a class where some historical poems that we were expected to read because they were written by those poets with mm-hmm. the big names.
Yeah.
That time, definitely white male dead poets, dead white males, as they say, because I'm an old guy. I went to school a long time ago. And we have more diverse curriculum now. And there is just I dreaded going to one of those classes in particular. I did not. My ninth grade teacher. I have a story about this. This is a funny story.
Funny stories.
Go ahead.
It was sort of a funny story. And I'm sorry, teachers. We all know this teacher. And I know that the people listening to this podcast, and I know that the people I'm speaking to in the podcast are not this kind of teacher, and we all would like to see them retire from teaching or get out. But my ninth grade teacher was the sort that the student editors of the literary magazine for the high school came in and asked if they could, you know, tell us about, you know, sort of asked her and said, well, there's no point. These are ninth graders. They can't write.
Oh my God!
But I guess I'll let you anyway, or something like that, and something. I can't remember, but I did almost to defy her. I submitted some poetry, and they put some of it right on the back cover. They put one of the things on because they liked it so much, and they accepted my poems, and I kind of thought, yeah. There you go. And then I went on, I moved high schools, and I went on to be an editor. Well, actually, I was an editor, it was the same high school. In my junior year, I was one of the three editors of that same literary magazine, and I was the first one who was allowed in the 11th grade to do that. The other two were seniors, and usually the creative writing English teacher only took seniors, but I was in her class, and she let me join the crew. So that was my student revenge.
Yes, student revenge.
But I didn't like her classes. I didn't like her approach. I mean, yes, I she looked down her nose at us, and the way she taught the poetry was, I've never liked classes. I was trying to think of any of the. Can't say that I had high or college teachers are like this. Thank goodness. But never liked the teachers who said, I've got the key that unlocks this text, and I'm going to tell you the truth of what it means. I like the teacher said, what do you think this means? What could it
exactly
mean? Which is what I try to do. Even in my academic reading courses or any courses, what does this mean to you? Again, we're back to that finding the students' voices and stuff, even in, you know, in everything. It's how does this relate to the student? That's that incorporative thing. How can the student incorporate this? How can you as a reader incorporate the words? I remember reading early some poets, and I think I've seen it attributed to more than one poet since, but, you know, it's like we can't control how readers read our poems, and readers often see things in the poetry that we didn't know were in it. When we look, when the reader points it out, we say, oh, yeah, I can see how you get that. It's there. It's in the poem. I didn't consciously put it there. Yeah.
That's a wonderful line to end the podcast, and I think in a way epitomizes and concludes whatever you have said so far. Michael, that was really, really inspiring and very insightful. And I think, you know,
thank
this
you.
Podcast, I think people should listen it maybe twice or three times so they can actually, get more ideas because you were, you know, in
I
the flow.
I speak fast too.
Yeah. No, everything was just fine. So we would like to thank you for
thank you. I'm honored that you invited me. Thank you very much. And it was a real pleasure meeting you in Chania and meeting you now, Jeannie. And I hope we can all meet again sometime, some
absolutely.
Conference or some Greek island.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm going to go off and try to find poetry that generates more poetry.
There you go. Thank you.
Based on what you said. Have
thank
a lovely day.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.